Once again, good morning. Welcome to Southeast Community Church. My name is Bob Rankin. Fourth and fifth graders, thank you so much for worshiping with us. For the rest of us, in just a minute, we're going to continue with our worship with the receiving of the offering. Before we do, I'd like to say, if you've given online, thank you so much for doing so. If you're interested in doing that, you can take a look in the program. You can see there's ways to give online. More importantly, though, if you take a look in the program, you'll see that there's a communication slip. If this is your first time here, you want to find out more about Southeast, there's a block you can check off, some information you can put down, and we'll get some stuff to you. If you need prayer, put it in there. If you need help with something, you need a request, you need to want to talk to someone, just put it on that slip. Give some contact information, and then on your way out the door, give it to one of the ushers or put it into one of the white buckets, and we'll get it to where it needs to go. But thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us today, as we worship our Savior, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Sometimes I can be a tad bit cynical with the things, and I like to read the newspaper a lot, and sometimes I read some stuff I just can't believe, and I read my own hometown newspaper a lot, well, the app for it, the Detroit Free Press, and I came across this byline a few weeks ago now, and it said this, by the Detroit Lions, if we can make the playoffs, we can win the Super Bowl. And I laughed when I read that, okay? Because the Lions have not, they've won one playoff game since 1957. I imagine Martin was running around in diapers at the time, okay? So that's how long it has been since we won, the Lions have won a playoff game. And so when I read that, you know, I laughed. But really it wasn't that fact that I knew that we weren't going to win the playoff game. We weren't going to win the Super Bowl. We weren't, you know, even if we made it in, it wasn't going to happen. It was because they said if. To me, sometimes, a lot of times, if can be a dangerous word. And I grew up and I kind of was taught that from my father. You know, he would always point out, like, you know, if flies carried six shooters, frogs wouldn't eat them. But, you know, he did it in a much more colorful way, okay? But yeah, I got the point. You know, if I have to qualify it, I really don't have a lot of confidence in my ability to get it done. And what happens to us as Christians, I believe, a lot of times, myself included in this, is when God speaks to our heart, when God comes to us and says something, we are scared, and we put a qualifier to it. When God comes to our heart and tells us that we need to give, we say, if I get a raise, I'm going to start tithing. If I get promoted, I'll be able to give. God comes and tells us that we need to serve, and we put this qualifier on it. You know, if I get off sea duty, I'm going to start working at the church. Or if my spouse has more time off during the week, I am going to get involved in what's going on around Southeast Community Church. Or when God says that we need to draw close to Him and meditate on His Word, we say back to God, if we have more time during the day, you know what? We would read the Bible. We do this, and what happens when we put that on there? We give ourselves an out. We put a qualifier because we know. And the thing is, when God speaks to us, when He shares with us His desires of His heart, we just need to do it. We need to do what God tells us and not say, if this happens, I'll do it. We need to follow God. The Bible tells us to trust in the Lord. Doesn't say trust in the Lord if. It says trust in the Lord. So that's what we as believers need to do. When God speaks to us, when God places something onto our heart, we need to act and we need to do it. And not say if. So as the ushers come forward, I just invite you now to take part in this offering, that we give back to God what He has blessed us with. And I want to leave you with two thoughts. The first one is, if you're not aware of it, the Lions made it into the playoffs, and they're out of it already. They lost last night, okay? You know, so it came true, you know? And if I stayed up to 11:30, even though I knew what was going to happen. But more importantly, when we know God is speaking to us, and we choose to say if, we will miss out on the blessings that God has in store for our lives. And that, no none of us wants to miss. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you so much for being our Lord and Savior and coming to us, God, and speaking to us and sharing with us, God. And God, let us hear you. Let us open our hearts. Let us open our minds. Give us the wisdom to understand your desires, Lord. And God, give us the strength never to qualify it with an if, just to follow you in faith, in trust. Trust in the Lord, God. So we trust that you take what you have given us, Lord, and we give back to you to use it as a blessing to further the name of Jesus Christ, to share with others in any way you desire, God. We just thank you for the opportunity to be part of something so great and so amazing. So, God, we pray that you just use this offering just for those things. We thank you, Lord. May your love, may your grace, and your blessings flow throughout every individual, every home this week. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
When I heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I heard the tender whisper of love.
Sorry I couldn't be with you today. I'm in North Carolina doing a wedding that I promised a year or so ago. But I just wanted to come to you today and let you know that I'm so excited about this new year, 2017, the year of the church. And we're going to be looking at God's church. And today, Jared's going to speak to you. And if you've never heard Jared before, I know he's going to touch your heart. He's a man who God's just worked in his life. He's my son, but God's working in his life, and he'll do an incredible message today. The one reason I wanted to stop and share with you today is that Dallas Holm is coming this weekend. In fact, he's going to be with us on Saturday night for a very special concert. And the concert will go, all the proceeds of the concert will go for the trip to Ethiopia. And we just want you to help us out with that, be here for that. Not only will he bless your heart, he'll minister. It really is not a concert like you maybe you've known before, but it's a time where he'll minister to your heart. Bring your family, bring your kids, bring your friends, bring your neighbors. You can buy tickets if you want. They're on sale. They're $10 in advance. They're $12 at the door, $5 for children 6 to 12, and under 6 will be absolutely free. And so he will be with us. He's an award-winning gospel singer, but more than that, he's a minister of the gospel. He's famous for the song Rise Again and many others. And I remember when I was in Texas and I was going through a very difficult time. One of his famous songs called I Saw the Lord came on the radio and lifted my spirits and helped me through a very difficult time. And I know he'll do that for you as well. Maybe you're going through a rough time, or maybe some things aren't right. Just come, relax that evening. Allow God's Spirit to speak to you. Aaron Unthank will be singing, and Julie Marlin will be singing as well. It's going to be an amazing time. So join us Saturday, January the 14th at 6 p.m. But if you want to come for dinner, it'll be by donations only from 4:30 to 6. We'll be having a chili dinner in the small auditorium. We encourage everybody to come out, and I guarantee you won't be sorry that you came, that God's going to do a work in your life that night. Thank you. Have a great service. How long was that, Mike?
Did I get it right? Okay. Just a couple things to add on to what Dad was saying. If you do want to buy tickets to the Dallas Holmes home concert, can't say Holmes because that's incorrect, Dallas Holm concert, you can purchase them at the coffee spot. You can get them, I believe, at the welcome desk, or you can pick them up during the week from the office. So there, I did my public service announcement for the morning. Before we get started, what I would like to do is I would like for us to pray together. Oh, pray again. Yeah, that's what we do. So it's okay. We're going to pray together as we go into what has been called the year of the church, and we discuss what the church is and how Jesus has decided to use the church. What I'm going to ask is that we come together and pray, and that we ask God to take any preconceived ideas that we may have of what the church is. I know that growing up, when we hear the word church, there's a lot of things that get tied to that. And based on what we've been told and the way that the word is used, we build a picture of what we think the church is. So what I'm going to ask is that as we pray, that we ask God to take that away, to move that out, that we are open to what it is that he has to share, that we are open to his voice, and that by the end of the day, we can, one of two things, we can either confirm the picture that we have in our head of what the church is, that we were in fact correct based on the teaching of Scripture, or if our outlook was a little off, that God will fix it, that he'll refocus it, and that we will see the church as he intended the church to be seen. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, and most holy God, we thank you for the time that we have to hear from you. We thank you for your word that was given to us, that we may know your heart, that we may receive your wisdom. God, help us to take whatever it is that we have in our minds that may stand in the way of what it is that you have to share today, and to move it to the side. We can hear you clearly. take away whatever it is that we may have made up in our mind to think the church is, and allow us to set it to the side so we can hear from you exactly what you want us to hear. And God, if we've walked in, any of us have walked in with heavy hearts or confusion, we ask that you would remove that, that you would allow us a peace and a joy as we hear from you. And God, we thank you for the privilege it is to hear from you and to hear through your word. And we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you've ever heard me speak before, I've made it very, very clear that I've spent my entire life in church. I can't remember a time that the Curtis family was not in church. My dad's been a pastor, a senior pastor, for I think about soon to be 32 years. And even before that, he was working in the church. This is something we did. Man, every Sunday morning, I knew where I was going to be. As a matter of fact, back in the day, every Sunday morning, Sunday evening, and Wednesday night, I knew where I was going to be. Amen? All right, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. And during the course of that time, of course, what the church is, it's kind of built in my mind over time. For me, church was somewhere I went, like I said, on Sunday night, Wednesday. It was a place where I had friends I'd get to go see. It was a place where my dad worked. The church has always been a large part of my life. It's almost like, sometimes we talk about it, it's almost like a second sister to me, because the church has just always been a big part of our family. And as I got older, I realized that not everybody looked at the church the same way I did. It wasn't necessarily as important to them. But even more so, what was interesting is that when people viewed the church, there was a lot of argument as to what the church is or what the church is supposed to be, and it ranged. I mean, it was like a person could start, 10 people could start a sentence with, "I believe the church is," and have 10 different endings to that sentence. Right, of course, the popular one is the church is where we go on Sunday. It's this building that we walk into, and not everybody is real big on that definition. However, we tend to kind of go back to that. Some say that the church is it's an experience. Church is experience. It's something you feel. It's something you get kind of caught up in, and it's an emotional thing. And some people will tell you that the church is a mission. Churches, what does the church do? That's what makes the church, is it's about doing, being involved in social issues and things of that nature. That's what the church is supposed to be. And then the popular answer is the church is the people. Church is the people. But what people? Right? The church is the people. Is it the people that show up on Sunday? Who is the church, right? So we say the church is the people. And what's strange is that it's like, so, you know, you find yourself going, well, are they all right? Or maybe two of them are right and one of them's wrong, or maybe two of them are right and two are wrong, and or maybe three of them are right and one's half right and only half wrong, or maybe only one of them is right and none of the others are. And there's a part of me that wants to ask the question, what do you think the church is? And unfortunately, this is the part that we as human beings, more specifically as Americans, we really don't like this. The truth is, it doesn't matter what we think, because we didn't create the church. And the one that creates is the one that gets to decide. And so what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at what the creator of the church had to say, a guy by the name of Jesus. And we're going to find out what exactly he calls the church. Because once again, it's very easy for each and every one of us to say, well, I believe the church is this, I believe the church is this. Like I said, the popular one that we all go back to is the church is the people. But the question then becomes, well, what people? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a look in the book of Matthew, and it's a scripture that Dad used last week. It's found in Matthew chapter 16. And it's a pretty popular verse, and we're going to hit the whole story of it. But Jesus says, upon this rock, I will build my church. Now, before we jump into that, I think it's important that we talk a little bit about the book of Matthew. Because, see, understand, when you look at the Bible is not just a bunch of writings that a bunch of people did and they all got squished together. Like, there was intention behind all of them, especially when you look at the New Testament. The New Testament is nothing but letters. It's a letter from one person to another, or a letter from one person to a bunch of others. But they're all letters. They're letters with intention. Of course, inspired by the Holy Spirit, but there was a purpose for them. They were going somewhere. So when you look at the book of Matthew, we believe that the book is named after the Apostle Matthew. I know, big shock. And there's plenty of evidence that leads us to believe that he did, in fact, write it. Now, the question is, who did he write to? Well, the audience of Matthew, the primary audience of Matthew, were Jewish believers, predominantly. They were Jewish believers, Jews that had decided, yes, I will, in fact, put my faith in Jesus Christ, that he is the Son of God, that he came, that he lived, that he died, that he rose again, that he is the payment for my sin. But what Matthew wanted to do is he wanted to help strengthen the foundation, not only of that belief, but the understanding that while Jesus was in fact and is in fact the Son of God and the sacrifice for all man's sin, he is also one of us, one of the chosen people, one of the Israelites. He is of the Jewish line. And this was very, very important because when you get to the end of the letter, right, Jesus does some great things as far as miracles throughout the course of the letter. But when you get to the end, Jesus makes some very strong claims that hinge on him being the Son of God, and at the same time, him being of that Jewish line gives even more credibility to what it is that he's saying, because he's fulfilling prophecy. Right? He's doing these things, and when Matthew does this, he likes to make connections. For instance, you can read about in the beginning when Jesus, when he was born, and after he was born, and Mary and Joseph took Jesus, and they fled to Egypt, and then they came back out of Egypt to Jerusalem. What Matthew would do is he'd say, I want you to understand the similarities in what Jesus did, and then what our people did, the Israelites, how they went in to captivity and how they were enslaved in Egypt, but then they came out because God let them out. And then he talked about how Jesus, you know, passed through the Jordan, and he wanted to make the connection between that and the children of Israel crossing the Red Sea. And he wanted to make a connection between how God gave his law on Mount Sinai, and Jesus gave his law in the Beatitudes on the mountain, right? So there's these connections over and over that we find between the Israelite story and the story of Jesus, the 40 years in the desert and Jesus 40 days in the desert, right? There's this connection that Matthew says, I need you to hear this, because when we get to the end of this letter, you're going to read some things that are going to be super heavy. And if your foundation and belief in Jesus and who he is not where it needs to, there is not a strong foundation, if it is not there, you're going to struggle with some of this. So, we fast forward, right? So you look at the story of Jesus through Matthew, and, you know, there's times that it's like, you ever read the Bible and you start judging the characters in it? Because it gets insane. Like, you read through the book of Matthew about all of these miracles that Jesus performs, right? He heals the sick. He feeds thousands and thousands of people with basically nothing, right? He just multiplies bread and fish and feeds and feeds and feeds. Well over 7,000 people, right? So he gets done doing that the second time, right? Feeding the thousands the second time. He gets done with that. He comes together with his disciples. They get on a boat and they're about to leave. And up to this point, Jesus has done some amazing things. And the disciples start talking to each other. And they realize after they get on this boat that they forgot to bring bread. Now, Jesus had this really, really cool knack for reading what was going on in people's minds. And so he found himself a situation where he could do some teaching. He says, they're thinking about bread. I'm going to share something about bread. He says, be careful of the leaven of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And they're like, yeah, so we forgot bread. So Jesus rebukes them. tells him, you don't have any faith. What is wrong with you? So finally, Jesus has this conversation with his guys, and he sits them around. And it's very important that we listen to the wording that Jesus uses in this conversation. So if you'll turn with me to Matthew chapter 16. And if you don't have a Bible, it's going to be up on the screen there. So Matthew chapter 16, starting in verse 13. This is where our conversation picks up. It says, now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? So there's two questions that are taking place here that I want you to pay attention to. Jesus is with his disciples, his group, the ones that he has chosen, the ones that he went to and said, follow me. And he asked them, who does everybody else, who do they say that I am? Well, they gave a lot of incorrect answers because Jesus was not any of them. But then Jesus said, now tell me, who do you think I am? And so what happens is Simon Peter replies, he says, you are the Christ. You are the Christ. You are the Messiah. You are the anointed one. That's what that word, all of it, you are God's chosen son. Is what that is all packed in those few letters that make up Christ. It says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. So, let's make sure that we're not missing anything when it comes to this conversation. There's Jesus, the guys that he has handpicked that follow him, the ones he said, follow me, and they said, okay. Asking them, who do these people think that I am? Okay. They think I'm Jonah, Elijah, whatever. Now, who do you, my group, my chosen people, the ones that walk with me, who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are the Messiah. You are the Christ. You are the Son of God. And then Jesus says something that we kind of get twisted sometimes, and I want you to stay with me so we make sure we don't make the same mistake. Oh, but it's very important, before I even get there, he says, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. So the ones that are with me that have the right answer, and oh, by the way, when it comes to Christianity, there are right and wrong answers. It's not a belief system that we can just make up as we go. Scripture tells us black and white. Right and wrong. That's how it is. Side note. I am not winning brownie points. We move on. So what he says, though, is he says that this has been revealed to you. So the right answer to this question, you didn't come up with on your own. But the Father gave it to you. So the people that are walking with Jesus, that are living with Jesus, that are doing life with Jesus, receive the answer of who Jesus is from the Father. We get that? They didn't come up with it on their own. The ones that came up with their own answer are the ones that are wrong. The ones that have the right answer, it was given to them by the Father. So then Jesus says this. He says, I tell you, you are Peter. So what he did is he changed his name, right? Peter in the Greek is rock. Petra means rock. Okay. So what he does is he tells Peter, or Simon Peter, he says, you are a rock. And the picture that he's giving us is a rock. Like if you go outside and you grab a rock, Peter, this is you. You are strong. You are... Then Jesus says, he then says, and on this rock, I will build my church. Now understand that he is not telling Peter that upon you, I will build my church. Because that doesn't make any sense. Right? Jesus is not going to put into the hands of a human being and say, you build my church. I'm leaving it up to you. Have fun. Make me proud. Because see, when he says upon this rock, now we're not talking the same wording here. This wording here, when Jesus says upon this rock I will build, he's saying upon this foundation, this very large, sturdy rock. Now what he's thinking now is he's thinking a large, vast rock. That what would I do on this rock? I would build a home. I would build a building. I would build some sort of a structure, right? A large structure. So he's not saying that Peter is the one that he's going to build on. He's saying based on what you have said, which is what? That Jesus is the Son of God. He is the Messiah. He is the Christ. On that, I will build my church. So now we have to look at that statement. So now Jesus has laid some groundwork, right? Once again, if I am the Son of God and I'm part of you, we are a part of this family, I want you to understand that this is what I'm doing. I will build my church. Now, what's interesting about this statement is that we spend a lot of time on the word that really means the least, really has the least importance, really has the least amount of power in the statement. Now, I'm going to be careful how I say this, because if it comes out wrong, I'm going to throw off everything that Dad wants to do during the year. But stay with me, okay? I'm not contradicting him. The word that we see in here that we make the big deal about is ekklesia, right? Jesus says, upon this rock I will build my church. The Greek word that is used for church is ekklesia. Now understand that church was just the word that they decided to use in translation. And it's not necessarily in the English translation. And it doesn't oftentimes build the exact picture that we need to see. But ekklesia is not a super spiritual word. It simply means this. It simply means an assembly and a gathering of people. As a matter of fact, if you do some research and you read Philo, who is a Jewish philosopher, he uses the word ekklesia, talking about just people coming together, just hanging out. Right? If we were a Greek-speaking community, when the school has an assembly, it would be called an ekklesia. Josephus, a Jewish historian, uses the word ekklesia to talk about assemblies, people. The word that we need to pay attention to in the statement of Jesus, and Dad mentioned it last week, is the word that in the Greek is mu, which simply means my. Because see, now the game's changed. It's gone from a gathering of people to a gathering of my people. Not a gathering of his people or her people or your people, a gathering of my people. Now, when we look at the word build, see, here's where it starts to get kind of crazy in this statement that Jesus gives us. Is that when you look at that word in the original language, at the root of that word is the word house or home. Okay? So when you look at the word that is used in the Greek for build, the picture that they want to paint for you is one of building a home, both structurally, but also edifying and building up and teaching. And raising. So when this word is used, it's not a word that just simply means I'm going to build my church. Because that wouldn't make sense if it was just a structure, right? Jesus says, you're right, Peter, upon this rock I will build a church. Jesus, I'm sure we can find better land, right? No, because they didn't think that way. That's not what he was saying. What he said was, upon this foundation, you say, and you're right, because my Father told you, I am the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. I will build, I will edify, I will grow up my assembly of people. And when I do that, the gates of hell cannot prevail. So see, what he wasn't saying is he wasn't saying that it was a building. And he's not even saying that it's a group of people. He's saying it's a group of his people. And that's huge. Huge. That was a bad impression, wasn't it? Huge. You're fired. But it's a big deal. Stay with me. Because once again, he's saying to these guys, it's going to be my people, and the way that my people are going to be grown and taught is going to be from the Father, right? The information you know comes from Him. That's what makes you my people. It's not anything you do. You do not choose to be, you did not wake up one morning and say, you know, I think I'm going to go find Jesus and be a part of His group. No, you were drawn to me and you were made one of my people. So what does God's people look like? All right, so clearly Jesus wants to build them. He wants to build them up, the people. He wants to edify. He wants to train. He wants them to become something. Just simply His people, but He wants to grow them in that. So what does that look like? So when you look at the Bible and the story of the Bible is, if we were going to kind of simplify the whole thing, the story of the Bible is God calling His people back to Him. It's the whole thing, right? If you ever want to know what perfect church looks like, even though the word was never used, look at the Garden of Eden. Read Genesis chapter 2. There is a perfect picture of church. You have man and woman in perfect relationship with God. They were God's people. They were obedient. They served Him. He blessed them. He said, this is what I want for you. This is what I want you to do for me. And they did. And then what happened? Sin comes into the world, the whole talking snake thing. Split, divide. Then what happens, right, when Adam and Eve have to leave the garden is there's a division. There's a division between man and there's between man and God. And so during the course of this time, there's some sort of a sacrificial system that is put into place. Now, I'm not as actually sure where it comes in or how it comes in, because by the time we get to the story of Cain and Abel, there is already this sacrifice, the sacrificial system taking place. So they knew that here is God, and there has to be atonement, there has to be payment, we need to reconnect. There was an urge to be God's people. So we fast forward, and you see some craziness take place in the Old Testament. If you've never read it, check it out. Side note, Bob was talking earlier about the word if. Did you know that if you take a look, we'll just say the Old Testament, if you take a look at the Old Testament and all the people that we see as the great men and women of God, how many of their decisions actually made sense? If this, then, yeah, God, then I'll follow you. Abraham didn't do it, right? When he just said, okay, I'll do what you tell me to do, great things happen. Now, there were times when he decided that he was going to do things his own way, and it did not turn out well. Moses. Did not make sense for Moses to go back into Egypt. But he did. Because God told him to do it. And now we talk about him today as one of the great, great men of God. So, let's go ahead and jump into where Moses is, right? So we fast forward to Moses, and there's been this process over the course of Genesis that leads us to Exodus. God had promised Abraham that he was going to give him many descendants, as many as there were stars in the sky. But he did tell him that your people are going to be in slavery for about 400 years, and this is what's going to happen, and so they were. So God sends Moses in to Egypt, and he then, through an incredible course of events, Moses leads the people out of Egypt into the wilderness, and they're on their way to the promised land, the land that God said hundreds of years before, I'm going to give my people. Now, during the course of this trek from Egypt to where we're going to read here in just a moment, there's a lot of things that happen, some craziness, the whining and the complaining the people love God, they didn't trust God, then they love God and they didn't trust God, and then God ends up with the Ten Commandments. Why? Because they needed to know that they needed God. See, when we don't know that we need God, we think everything's okay. We start to do things like, well, at least I'm not as bad as that person. At least I'm not as bad as that person. Ooh, this person should be punished so incredibly bad. My stuff's not as bad as them. Right, those are the kind of things we do when we don't understand the law of God. Because I need to make something very clear before we move forward. A lot of times we stand on the wrong side of thought and conversation when it comes to God and who He is. We say things like, I can't believe there's a loving God that I would allow pain and suffering. Again, we're standing on the wrong side of the statement. Because if God is who the Bible says he is, and if you don't believe that God is who the Bible says he is, then don't bother even thinking about God, because you're just making him up, right? But if God is who the Bible says he is, do you realize that each and every one of us should feel the most immense and horrible pain that we could ever even think of every second of every day because we have disobeyed him? I mean, do you realize that? That if God was a horrible God, we would not experience a moment of joy in our lives at all because we have sinned against him, whether we know it or not. Scripture tells us that we sin against God and not know it, and we're still held accountable for it. So if God isn't a God of grace and mercy, well, then we should all be suffering immensely as I speak. You get what I'm saying? So make sure we're standing on the right side when we look at who God is. The simple fact that we don't experience destruction and pain every moment of every day shows that God is a God of love and mercy. Well, I'm not that bad. Read your Bible. Read your Bible. We're all that bad. That's why we needed Jesus. We're all that bad. So, it gets even worse, right? So Moses comes down from the mountain. He's got the Ten Commandments. And what happens? This is one of the weirdest stories. This is why you don't put your faith in man, you put your faith in God. Moses comes back down. They're worshiping a golden cow. He goes to his brother Aaron. Aaron is the high priest. He says, what's going on? Aaron says this. I kid you not, read your Bible. I can't make this up. He says, yeah, it was the weirdest thing. So we gathered up all the gold, and we put it in a fire, and out came this calf. So what did God do? God called I believe it was the Levites together. He said, who's your God? So we serve the God, one God, mighty God. He said, take out your swords, and I want you to handle this. And thousands died that day. Interesting enough, let's keep this in mind, that thousands of Israelites died that day. Hebrews died that day because they disobeyed God. But they were part of the assembly. They were part of the group that came out of Egypt. But were they God's people? But see, even after all of that, let's look at what God says. Let's move to Exodus chapter 29. See, when you read the Old Testament, I don't know about you, but when I read it, it's one of those times where I find myself going, man, it's a good thing I'm not God. People talk about the Old Testament being about a God of anger and a God of wrath and rage. The whole thing is dunked in grace and mercy. Like if God is who God says he is and his word is true, we shouldn't have a second chance. And he gives them over and over and over. And here's what he says. After all of this, this is what God says to Moses when they're standing their time together. He had just gotten done saying, I want you to build a tabernacle. And tabernacle simply means to dwell with, to be among, right? But that's the name of this tent where God was going to dwell with his people. And he says, this is how I want it to be built. And he gave specific detail. He said, I want these colors. I want these fabrics. I want these materials. And he said, this is how it's supposed to be done. He talked about incense burners. He talked about altars. He talked about all of these things. This is how I want you to build the tabernacle where I will meet with my people. What he did not say is, I want to meet with my people. It's up to you to make it happen however you want. No, again, he said, you are my people and we will meet on my terms. Well, once again, we find ourselves thinking, well, that's kind of a rude thing for God to do. I mean, why would he do something like that? Let me ask you a question. Let's say that you're in a relationship, okay? And let's say that in that relationship, there's two people, and one of those two people knows how to have a perfect relationship. Who's going to make the call? I mean, let's be serious. If between Laura and I, if I knew how to have a perfect relationship, I know that she would never question anything I had to say. Now, we know it's not true, thus the laughter. Thanks. But wouldn't it make sense? So what God says is this, for our relationship to be good, for you to be my people, for me to be your God. You are going to have to do these things. This is what I want. And when you do these things and you make this place the way I tell you to make it, we will meet, we will be in relationship. And after he gets done giving this instruction, here's what he says in 29 verse 42. 43, excuse me. He says, "There I will meet with the people of Israel, and it shall be sanctified by my glory." Not by the people? Ooh, I almost did a dad thing. My, but we're not doing that. He says, "I will consecrate the tent. I will consecrate the tent of meeting and the altar. Aaron also and his sons, I will consecrate to serve me as priests. I will dwell among the people of Israel and will hear their and be their God, and they shall know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them out of the land of Egypt, that I might dwell among them. I am the Lord their God." And as you read through the Old Testament, you see that language of, we are your people, you are our God, you are my people, I am your God. There's an ownership, and it's all God's, and it's everything that God is doing. God is consecrating, God is directing, God is doing all of these things so that we can be in a relationship with him. So we can assemble with him. So now we fast forward, right? So we're looking at the tabernacle, and as the time goes on, there is the temple comes into play. And David wants to build the temple. God says, "I love your heart, but you have blood on your hands. I cannot let you do it." But his son Solomon does build the temple, and you find the same thing. God's saying, "This is what I want. This is what I want. This is what I want." And something that's very important to remember that followed from the tabernacle through the temple is that God's presence was there. They could visibly see by cloud that God was there. And so there's all of these steps that have to take place. There has to be payment. The priest has to do this. He has to be prepared this way to go in, to meet with God, to pay for the sins, to cover the sins of those that follow. So there's this big, long process, but God said, "I'm going to tell you the process because this is what it's going to have to take for you to what? To be my people." And so we move forward. So now we have the temple. When you read the end of the Old Testament, things go crazy. The temple's destroyed. They come back through. They rebuild the temple. But what it tells us, what Scripture tells us, is that the Holy Spirit did not necessarily dwell there anymore. And then everything went silent. Until one day, this crazy guy comes out of the wilderness. And he's like, wearing weird skins and eating bugs. And he starts preaching of the one to come. So now what's happened, when we open up the New Testament and we start to look at the Gospels, we see the entrance of God again. This time he is not coming as a spirit in a cloud, but he has come into the world as a baby who is going to grow and be the Messiah. What I want to read is the book of John. I talk about that book all the time. It's an interesting book to me. I love how John, who was kind of like best friends with Jesus, they were like real close. He was with him from the beginning. So you're taking everything as kind of a firsthand account with John. And what John does in his book is just amazing to me, is I love the way he opens it in that first chapter. He says, "In the beginning was the Word." Talking about, he said, "The Word was with God, and the Word was God." And that Word, that very thought, that very perception, that very thought process of God became flesh and walked among us. So Scripture tells us that God himself came to earth to start the process of reclaiming. Who brought Jesus to earth? Nobody. The people that were going to the temple didn't bring Jesus to earth. Who brought Jesus? Well, nobody brought. God sent. So once again, where in the steps so far have we seen where it's up to us how the people of God operate or become? I think he's kind of laying it all out for us. Then we get into the second chapter of John. And this one is a favorite of friends of mine because it starts with miracle. Jesus turns water into wine. Now, what a great story. What a great story. The Son of God comes down. He goes to a wedding. They run out of wine. Mary, Jesus' mom, comes to him, and she's like, hey, we're out of wine. And he says, paraphrasing, he's like, so what does that mean to me? And so just like any good mom, I'm sure she gave Jesus the look, and then she turned to the servants and said, do whatever he says, which means you're going to fix this, right? And so what Jesus does is he gets the water, he turns it to wine, and what we find out is that it's the best wine they've had all night. Now, people are going to try to tell you that wine was non-alcoholic. Not that I'm going to look in any direction, but I'm sure that there's wine drinkers in here that can tell you that once you get to the fourth bottle, it don't matter how cheap it is. You'd be drinking Mad Dog thinking, this is all right. But what happened is these people saw and went, this is the best we've had, right? So then, after Jesus spends time there, does a miracle to show his power, his strength, who he is, he moves on, and in John chapter 2, or later in John chapter 2, he comes to the temple. Now, when you read the Gospels, there's a couple different stories that have to do with the temple. I am of the belief that the whole temple thing is not just one event. I believe that Jesus had a few events where he caused a ruckus. Because if you read in the other Gospels, you're going to find that you're like, wow, so the Bible must be inaccurate. No, I believe that Jesus made himself known at the temple and didn't have a problem with it. And he didn't just take one time to throw things around. He was going to make it very clear. Why? Because he tells us when he shows up what the issue is. Let's read. So I'm going to start in verse 13. Scripture says that the Passover of the Jews, 2:13. Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen, and he poured out the coins and the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold pigeons, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered this, remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. So I'm going to stop right there just for a second. So what Jesus is telling us, the Son of God in the flesh, visiting the temple, he's saying, this is my father's house of prayer. This is what we know as the place to where we come to meet with God. And you are doing something there that doesn't fall in line with that. See, what was going on is that the Passover was taking place. And the Jews would all come in to Jerusalem during the course of the Passover from wherever they were. So they would have to travel. Some would have to travel extensive space and time to do this. And so it would be kind of difficult to carry all the necessary sacrifices. So what would happen is merchants would set up to sell the sacrifices necessary. Well, you can figure how that goes, because when man gets involved, we kind of mess things up. So what was happening is there was price gouging, there was exchange rate, it was all kinds of jacked up, and they were stealing from people in the temple. Understand, the temple is where people meet with God, and what's going on in the temple is not acceptable to God. And it's got to change. So what happens is Jesus chases them all out. He says, this isn't okay. And then the religious leaders were like, well, who are you to make this decision? They say, I'm going to start in verse 18. So the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? Jesus answered, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. So what Jesus said is this, I'll prove to you who I am. Destroy this temple 3 days, I'll build it back up. And they're like, that's crazy. What the scripture tells us, though, is that he says, his body is the temple that will be resurrected. When you read on in the New Testament, How is the church referred to? It's referred to as the body of Christ. Right? So not only when Jesus raised from the dead both physically and he was spiritually taken up, Scripture tells us that we, the believers, become the temple of the Holy Spirit. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians, was it 6? Yeah, 1 Corinthians 6, that we are temples of the Holy Spirit and that we have been bought with a price. So what Jesus has told them is the temple's not yours to do with it whatever you want to do. Paul's telling us that our bodies aren't ours to do with it whatever we want to do. So where in Scripture is it telling us that who and what the church is up to us? So let me tell you what's happened here in these Scriptures that we've shared. And I know sometimes I can be confusing, and I apologize. I'm going to make this very, very clear. That in every one of these situations that we've looked at from beginning to end, God does the deciding. God sets everything in motion. God sets the course. Scripture says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Okay? Who is it that says how the temple is supposed to be built? Who dictated all the ins and outs of it? Right? So if we are, in fact, the temple of the Holy Spirit, that means the Holy Spirit lives in us. We have become a place where the Spirit wants to meet with us, and it is up to Him how we are built up. See, it's then and only then when the Spirit lives in us through salvation that we are a member of God's family. And not until we become a member of God's family can we be a part of the assembly. See, when Jesus said, I will build my assembly, I will teach them, I will train them, he was talking about those who have accepted the free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. And just like everybody we've talked about, there was people that showed up in the temple, people that stood around the tabernacle, people that were a part of the Israelites coming out of Egypt, that were a part of a group, but they were not part of the assembly. They were not God's people. And see, the scary thing is this, is that there's people in here today that will show up every week and you'll sit in a room with a bunch of people. You may sing, you may raise your hands, you may do all the church things, and you are not a part of the church. See, the truth is this, that I can stand up here and I can talk to you about everything that's in that book, but that does not mean, nor does it dictate whether or not I am a part of the church. Or that I am a part of the assembly. Or that I am a temple of the Holy Spirit. But you know who decides that? God. See, what I can tell you is that one day, a long, long time ago, I felt this little, I might have been 6 years old, and I felt this little nudge on my heart to say, hey, you want Jesus to be in your heart? Because see, I was lucky enough to have a dad that early on would say, hey, listen, if you ever want to ask Jesus into your heart, you just let me know. Okay. A couple days later, if you ever want to ask Jesus in your heart. Okay. Sitting in the back of a vehicle, we were driving to Tallahassee, Florida. And I felt that, hey, I want to be in your heart. So I said, hey, Dad, I want Jesus in my heart. And so I don't even remember what the prayer was. And since then, God's been working on me and building. And man, I've made some horrible choices. I've made some horrible, horrible, horrible choices. I've done everything I could to tear this temple down, I promise you. But see, I was His. Because He first came to me. And so, on one side, the truth is that you may be here and you may sit in here every week, but you have never been His. You have never surrendered yourself to Him. And the Bible tells us that at the end of the day, when your time's up, you will spend eternity without Him. But He doesn't want that. He tells us that He is not willing. He's just, I'm not willing that any should perish, For God so loved the world, you know this one, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. See, I believe that the scripture teaches us that God will interact with each and every person on planet Earth at some time in their life. And he's going to give them the opportunity. And that's all we get, is the opportunity to surrender our life to him. But when we do, we reap the benefits of being in his assembly, to be part of his family, his blessing, his joy, all of those things that you hear about that you always want and you can't figure out why Christianity doesn't work, because I go to church every day, I sing the songs, I raise my hand, I pray the prayers, but I'm not doing anything to submit to God, and I don't feel like I'm a part of it. See, the great thing about all that we've talked about, as complex as it may sound, is it all starts with simply submitting to God and allowing him to bring you in. You know, the truth is this, is that you can do all kinds of church things. You can go out and you can raise money for the poor. You can take care of the widows and the orphans. You can take care of homeless. You can do all of these things that are good things that are the product of God working in you, the product of him building your temple so that you can be who it is that he wants you to be, and you can connect with others in an assembly, but those on their own mean nothing if you're not part of the family. So then the question becomes, are you in or out? See, for some of you here, you've made that decision. God has pulled on your heart. You're like, yes, that's me. Yes, right? You're all for it. And God's doing great things in your life. Some of you have made a decision. You're like, ah, you know, whatever. And you moved on, and quite frankly, your temple's starting to look a little nasty because you haven't allowed the Holy Spirit to work in it. Now, there's some of you here that are like, I don't even know what's going on. Like, temple, tabernacle, but I just know this. I don't know Jesus anything like what you're talking about. As a matter of fact, you may even have right now this tugging in your heart that says, hey, I'm Jesus. I want to live in your heart. I want to start today. I want to turn your wreckage, your building that you've built yourself into the temple that I intended it to be so that I may live with you. And oh, by the way, as I'm living in you, I'm calling you to be a part of my people. And boy, that family, that assembly is so vast and so wide. Now, once you're in, you don't want to leave. And I don't mean inside of a building. I mean a family of the Most High God. So if you're here today and you're feeling that tug, that I want to be a part of the family of God. I don't even know what it means, but I know I want Jesus in my life, and I want to be a part of his people. I want to give you an opportunity. I want to give you an opportunity to start a life with him. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask everybody to close their eyes and bow their heads for a moment. And don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to say anything you don't want to say or do anything. I mean, if you don't care and don't want anything to do with it, it's fine. Just be kind to those around you and don't stare and look around. But if you're here today and you want to start this relationship with God, I want to help. I want to give you that same option that my dad gave me so many years ago. And that is the opportunity to ask Jesus Christ to come live in your life. So here's all you got to do. It's super simple, right? Because God does everything. He did everything. And all he needs from you is for you to say, yes, I surrender to you. So what I want you to do first is I want you to start by addressing God for who he is, as he is. God, you are mighty. God, you are powerful. You are the Lord of all. You are the mighty creator. Understand who we're talking about here. The God of the universe is who you're talking to right now. Then what I want you to do is I want you to tell him that you believe that Jesus is who the Bible says he is. Even if you don't totally understand it, but you understand enough to say, yes, I agree with Jared. I'm going to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he came to earth, that he lived the perfect life, that he was crucified for my sins, and I'm putting my trust in him. Take a moment and tell him. And then there's the hard part, and this is the part that we all struggle with, but God is asking us. He's saying, please, please, please give me this opportunity. Ask him to forgive you. Ask Him to forgive you of everything that you've done. Because let's be honest, we know we've done jacked up stuff, all of us. And God knows about all of it. And He's saying, please, if you just ask me forgiveness, we can start this relationship. We can open the door. I will walk you through this. I will begin to build you into that temple I want you to be and bring you into my assembly. So we ask for that forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy and your willingness to continue to come after us even when we don't deserve it, God. None of us has ever done anything that would warrant your grace and your peace. Nothing. As a matter of fact, we've done everything we could to rid ourselves of it, to put ourselves in a situation where we are just miserable, but you keep loving. Your grace has overflowed from your assembly to those that don't even know you. But God, may they know you today. And for those that have made that decision that they are asking Jesus Christ in their heart, God, I ask that you give them a passion, that you give them a fervor that cannot be quenched. Give them an excitement, God. We thank you for their lives. And God, for those that do know you, but man, it's time to do some housekeeping. To get rid of everything that we believe that we control, but give it all back to you and just learn to surrender to you and let you lead us so that we can be your people and you can be our God. In Jesus' name, amen. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask everybody to stand, please. And what we're going to do is we're going to give you a time to spend some time with God. What we're going to do is in a moment, the gang's going to play and we're going to give you an opportunity to come down and to speak one-on-one with God. If you have questions, if you have concerns, or you can talk to one of these trusted people. They want to pray with you and whatever's going on in your life. If you made that decision, if you asked Christ into your life, very first time ever, Jesus knocked, you opened the door, your life has changed, I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to run up and down the aisle. You got a program when you came in and there's a slip, and on that slip it says something like, I've committed my life to Christ, or I've surrendered to Christ, something along those lines. I'm going to ask you to check that. And on your way out, I'm going to ask you to give it to Troy, who's in the back. He's got his hand raised. You know, Troy, he was up here earlier. Welcome to everybody here. So see, you already got a relationship. It shouldn't be awkward, right? You can give him that slip, and he's going to give you some information. If you want to talk to him, he'll talk to you. If you want to hug, he'll hug you, whatever the case may be. But if you don't want to talk to him, like you don't feel real comfortable, just take what he's giving you and take it home with you. I don't want to see anybody walk out and be in a place where, like, I don't know what to do. So I did what Jared said, and now I'm confused. Because see, what has happened is you've now become a part of the assembly. And I want you to know, whether or not you know this, for those of you that have decided to follow Christ, to put your trust in Him, you're in a room of other people that have done the same, and they want to help you. The same way that God spoke into the lives of the Israelites, the same way Jesus brought the word, these people have been touched, their lives have been changed, and they want to share that with you. You have not done something that has now put you out on your own. You have joined the family of the Most High God. Amen? So if you have anything to pray about, I just want to talk or pray with somebody, please take this opportunity to do so. I'm going to pray one more time. And these guys are going to play the song, and you know what to do. If you want to come pray, or just let God move in your life. God, we love you. We thank you. We praise you. And I ask that you continue to work in the lives of everybody that's here right now, God, that you continue to move in their spirit, that you continue to draw them closer to you, God. May every heart that feels the tug today allow you to work in them. In Jesus' name, amen.